Jerry Lewis.
We're the Playboys.
And welcome to the Mike Douglas Show with Mike's co-host, Jack E. Leonard. And now, here's Mike.
She loves me, and to my amazement, I love it, knowing that she loves me. I love her, truth she doesn't show it. How could she, when she doesn't know it? Yesterday she loathed me, bah, now today she likes me, ha, huh? And tomorrow, tomorrow, ah, my teeth ache from the urge to touch her. I'm speechless, or I mustn't tell her. It's wrong now, but it won't be long now before my love discovers that she and I are lovers. Imagine how surprised she's bound to be. She loves me. She loves me. I love her. Isn't that a wonder? I wonder why I didn't want her. I want her. That's the thing that matters, and matters are improving daily. Yesterday I loathed her, bah, now today I like her, ha, and tomorrow, tomorrow, ah, I'm tingling, such delicious tingles. I'm trembling, what the heck does that mean? I'm freezing, that's because it's cold out. But still, I'm incandescent, and like some adolescent, I'd like to smile on every tree I see. She loves me. She loves me.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
I think you should, because we're working for you.
I'd like now to introduce you to...
I don't want to come out there, but...
Captain Kangaroo of the Stone Age, Mr. Jack E. Leonard. Here he is. Let's really hear it for Big Jack.
Not too loud, please. It's a very old building, you know. How are you? Geez, I'm sure glad to see you, Mike.
Thank you.
I like your new haircut and everything.
Thank you.
You combed it from the ear. This is really remarkable. You've been on this show now how long?
Oh, about 3.5 years.
It's amazing, Jack, what America has to offer our people, isn't it?
Don't you like the show?
Oh, I think it's wonderful. It's one of the best shows I've ever seen. I'm not kidding. You're a big hit in New York now with it, too. And you got a tough hour. You go on between 5 and 6.5. No, that's 5 and 6:30.
Yes.
This is what they call hip talk. Yeah. There's a little girl that's fully 7 years old, and she's already fallen in love with me, you see it?
I know that. I can see by the way she's looking.
She's got stars in her eyes. Her mother just hit her in the head, that's why.
You're hot today, aren't you?
I'm hot today, boy. All I know is I came from Florida, and I made a wild picture with a girl called Phyllis Diller, and that's pretty hard to overcome, you know.
What's the name of the picture?
It's called The Fat Spy.
Is that
I'm not
going really
to play a dual role and don't say, well, you're big enough to do it.
I won't say
don't talk when I'm working, will you, please? After all, you're here all the time. I see your band's improved. You got an organ now. I play a dual role in this thing. It's kind of a nice picture.
You told me to stop talking, Jack.
I know that. And you know something?
Slow,
you sound
know?
Better that way. I'll be
right.
Put your hands off and I'll start. This woman here is so bored with me right now. She's giving me one of those polite, you know, like, what do you call it? What's the name of that town? My brother lives in it.
Euclid?
No, he lives over there. Not Shakerhouse. The other poor part of town. Cleveland Heights. She looks like one of those kind of ladies. Oh, he's here again, isn't that true?
Say, you
I'm
were...
only kidding you. You'll be very happy next Halloween. The brooms are going to be cheap this year.
Oh, Jack, that's unkind.
I'm
now,
only
that's
kidding.
A sweet
it's all
lady.
Fun. I got in trouble with an audience.
He doesn't mean any of that.
Yes,
you know,
I do.
He's
please believe me.
He is a softie.
I'm
you
not
mean?
A softie. I got about...
He's a very sentimental man and a very sensitive man.
I don't need you to.
Why do you try that? What? That's all veneer with you.
That's all what? Veneer? I thought that's linoleum. Is that what it is? I'll leave you alone. I got my big
nice
star.
Nice teeth, you know, Jack.
Sure, I have a nice teeth. It cost me $4,000 up here. That's a nice cab job.
It is. Beautiful.
I'm rather attractive, I think, for one of the fellas that I am, I'll tell you right now.
You'll never believe this, but he used to be a lifeguard.
What do you mean you'll never believe it? If I were around right now, I'd throw you back in.
Well, because you don't look like a lifeguard.
I don't
Jack.
Look like a lifeguard,
you
no.
You look like an inner tube, but not like a lifeguard. No. It's
See, now watch. See how sensitive? See?
I'm not sensitive.
You don't
sensitive,
like it
Mike.
When people zing you back, do
Mike,
you?
Mike, you're not supposed to zing anybody. You're supposed to be the missionary worker on this show. And if you keep...
Listen,
yeah.
I'm not going to fence with
don't
you, Jack. I know
that.
How fast you are.
I've seen some of your shows, Mike, and I want to talk to you about your future. I think you have a fine future, Mike, and your voice is really improving. It's coming through your eyes now, you know.
I
you
think
have a nice
so,
voice,
Jack.
Mike. Don't kid.
Thank you.
It's amazing how a kid like you who used to sing around Chicago in the choirs, even on the high holidays, we had to pay it. You're one of the few that got that kind of money around. It was wonderful.
Yeah.
I've known Mike since... Where are you going? Who's this fellow here?
That's my producer.
He thinks he's when he gets to the office.
Let's talk about you.
I think you should.
Now, be honest with me. One time before I started talking to you about what kind of a kid were you? Were you like this as a kid?
What do you mean? No, I was afraid. That's why I got this attitude. You know, this is what they call a defense mechanism. I couldn't get an erector set, so I had to do something, you know.
You mean you started cutting people up?
I got that. I'll tell you how this whole thing started. I was kind of a wisecracking kid, like all kids. But when I went on with the big name bands years ago, you remember?
Yes.
Or don't you?
Sure, I do.
I'll tell them your real age, Mike. Don't get out of line at all. When you were with the boy vocalist with John Philip Sousa, I remember that very well.
He paid me off in jawbone.
Go ahead, Jack. And I went to work with the bands. I started to kid the bands. This band should disband and all that kind of jazz. And then I...
That's not too funny.
No, I know it wasn't, Mike, because you wouldn't understand my type of humor. That's why you're sitting there with your arm folded, and you'll be buried in a few minutes, I'll tell you right now.
You notice I wore the right kind of a suit in case
yes,
we died today?
That's very good. You died. You're a nice fellow, Mike. You have a great future, and I hope you get past 5 o'clock.
Well, go ahead. No, were you like this as a kid?
No, I'm a nice fellow now. This is my type of humor.
It's like...
You have a certain way of singing, which is not too clever, you know.
Well, did people get upset with you?
Oh, they did at the beginning, yes. I one time almost got killed in Miami Beach.
For what? I
said, there's my boss sitting with his wife and his girl. I didn't know I was telling the truth. He said, hey.
Harvard man, huh?
That's right, yes. He used to say, sit down, have a sandwich. You know,
I see.
Yeah. Well, like he was a graduate of Harvard, like he majored in English, you know, an English major.
Yes.
He started every sentence with the letter M, like, well, what are you doing today, you know? Very interesting. He drove me around his old neighbor, too, and they burned a cab on the way over just for fun.
Sing a song, Jack.
You've
got
to
show him how much talent you have. Jack?
Oh,
Jack.
Just my luck, when I go to bed tonight, I'll probably dream I'm awake. And I'm not used to playing to such a young audience anymore, you know? I'll tell you why, because...
Why?
It's been so many years since I played a neighborhood theater. And that woman still hates me. Isn't that amazing?
She doesn't
I think
hate
she's
you.
My sister-in-law. I got a sister-in-law. My brother lives in this town, you know.
I know it.
Yeah.
What does he do?
He's a bum. Oh. He's one of the...
Oh!
My brother is probably the finest man I've ever known in my life. He's the direct opposite of me. I'm not kidding you. He is a man who was a scoutmaster. He used to run boys' clubs in Chicago and all that kind of jazz. He's an accountant. You know, me, I was nothing. You know, I got thrown out of my first year at college. I had a scholarship, you know, because of swimming.
Yes.
I was a big swimmer, you know.
He was,
and,
really?
I was, yes. I already was. And,
did you like college?
I was there 2 months in the first semester. I wasn't there too long to know anything. You see, they used to fix my marks in high school so I could, you know...
So you could be eligible for swimming, yeah?
Yeah, they used to call me Chicken of the Sea. I was such a...
I
knew Charlie Tuna before I went back into the can.
Did you learn anything while you were at Northwestern for the
No, I didn't learn a thing at all. I was only there 2 months, and I only skipped about 22 days of that, you know. I got thrown out of high school. That was the biggest mistake I ever made in my
life. Thrown out of high school?
Well, I didn't get thrown out. They fixed my marks. I should have been thrown out. But I became a star anyhow, and I put 13 people through school, so that was pretty good.
Did you? Now, he's probably serious. Did you put 13 people through
school? Well, 12. One we're expecting. My niece just had a kid the other day, so I guess she'll go to college.
But you put all the rest of them through heaven?
I put a few through school. I'll be very honest with
you.
Right now, my family owes me.
Didn't I?
My family right now owes me $947,000.
Well, right now.
I expect to get a. You're talking in my line.
I'm sorry, Jack.
Jeez,
I never know when you're going to stop.
Mike, why do you wear a rented watch?
I can't.
I'd love to do this.
Can't you do that?
No.
Can you cross your legs?
Are you kidding?
Can you? Try it this way.
Look out there, Mike.
Sing a song for you.
I don't want to sing, Mike, because after all, you're a big singer, and you got the young kid, that Gary Lewis.
Nothing happened.
He's a nice kid. Well,
Gary Lewis.
Gary Lewis will be on there. Aren't you thrilled about that, kids?
Sure they are. Took them a long time to get through, though.
Well, as kids, after all, are still stoned, you know. And, I'll tell you, I made a picture with Jerry Lewis last summer called The Disorderly Orderly. I did what they call a cameo, small part, but starring.
Yes.
And, I did an insane TV comedian, and I used Jack Carter as my image. And it was a lot of fun work with Jerry. He was very nice. He gave me the suits they made for me at Side of War, a very famous place. You know, I just made a picture with Weston. Did you want to talk about my work?
What do you think of the picture? You think it's going to be funny?
Well, I don't know. They told me the Russians were very funny with Phyllis, and of course, I'm played
you
two parts.
You haven't seen it yet?
No, I haven't seen it. No, they're still working. The kid that just married Sybil Burton, you know, is...
He's in the picture?
He's in the picture. He's called. His name is Jordan Christopher. He's just Macedonian from Akron, Ohio.
Yes, I know.
And he's a nice
is he
kid,
good
too.
In the picture?
Yes, he's. Oh, I don't know. He's just starting to do. They're doing the musical parts now. I did a dance the other day called a turtle. I had to bury myself in the sand. All I knew was a little water coming out of my head, and I might have been shocked, you know.
Will you sing a song?
Why, I don't know. I don't know whether I should or not. It's an old song. It's called Somewhere in This Wide, Wide World, There's a Wide, Wide Girl for Me. I see you still have Ellie on the piano. She's
yes.
wonderful.
Yes.
She's a lovely girl. Is there any truth to rumor that this show is going to move?
Yes.
I heard you're going to Philadelphia.
We are going to Philadelphia.
That used to be the capital of our country at one time, but when you see the town, you'll understand why they had to move out of Philadelphia.
You know what he once said? Tell him what you said in the club in Philadelphia.
No, this is in Boston.
No, but don't you remember? You can have the bell.
Oh, yeah, what? I said in Boston. I was playing Philadelphia. No. And I said, I got mad. I said, if you people had any class, you'd shut up the Liberty Bell. And in Boston, I also got in trouble, too, and I got mad at the audience there.
What'd you say there?
I said, if I were Paul Revere, I never would have warned you.
He doesn't want to sing.
I have a lot of friends in those towns. Of course, the reason I'm not too thrilled about Philadelphia, my wife comes from there, you know. My mother-in-law used to swing with Benjamin Franklin many years ago. She sold all the blue thread to Betsy Ross, man. I don't know how old she is, but she's got a bum leg from falling out of covered wagons, I'll tell you that. That woman still hates me now.
No. We'll be right back after this.
I never saw a show blow all his dignity in my whole life. This guy's a producer of the show. Did you see him take a fall?
He fell down laughing at you.
Yeah, how come he hit his head, too? There's something wrong with the producer on this show. I tell you, once you get a little confident, you're through. I'll tell you right now. He was such a nice kid when they threw him out of Western Reserve. They caught him in the locker room, you know, stealing sneakers, you know.
Oh, come on. You want to meet a real nice man?
Well, I'd like to meet a couple of nice men, matter of fact.
This man is a fan of yours, because I've talked to him.
I know who you're talking about. He's one of the most gentlemen I've ever met in my entire career.
One of the nicest men, and has had a fantastic career, and I knew he was going to be just the way he was when I met him, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome the great Andy Devine to our show. Here he is. Jack turned up and said, they hate you. Are you kidding?
No, I'm only kidding. They love it. What are you doing? You're going to get me killed here. This guy made a fortune making cowboy pictures. Are you kidding?
Watch that microphone.
You know why he quit, don't you? Because they ran out of Indians. This is an old friend of mine, Annie. A real nice guy. He used to be the mayor of all the towns around that territory years ago.
I know. You've lost a lot of weight, Andy.
Yes, he has. I'd like to know where it went to. It must have fallen on me.
Jack found it, as he said.
You lost a lot, though.
No,
really.
I did. You know, a long time ago, I met Jack. This is very funny. About, I guess it's about 8 or 9 years ago.
It was 1957, actually.
Right. And Jack said, at that time, he had lost an awful lot of weight. And he said, you better watch yourself. You'll end up with diabetes, you know. I wish I'd have listened to him.
Well, what difference
did you really?
So he did.
No, he hasn't got diabetes. You kidding?
Why?
There's no room for it.
How did you get started in the business? I understand there's a great story connected with that.
Well, there really isn't a great story. I was just looking
unusual.
For work, you know.
And, any kind of work?
Any kind of work. Mm-hmm. I. This was end of 1925, which was 40 years ago. And my father passed away in Los Angeles. I was in Arizona at the time, mm-hmm. which was my home, and I went in there for the funeral, and I spent a couple of days, and I said, well, I'll look around and see what's going on here. And I had a sweater with a football letter on it, and a fella in an old Model T Ford stopped and said, do you know how to play baseball? And I said, yes. He said, they're looking for ball players at Universal. They were making a series of college pictures called the Collegians, which is before a lot of these people were born out there. And I went out with him and stayed on that one lot for 20 years. I was there from 1926 to 1946.
That's a great story.
Yeah.
I understand you're John Wayne and you are very close friends.
Yeah, Duke and I have been friends.
Is that what his name is?
Well,
his fans call him Duke?
Duke. And Duke and I, well, I first met Duke, and I was in pictures at the time, and he was still going to the University of Southern California. He was playing football, and we were doing a lot of football pictures in those days, and Duke was one of the players, and Ward Bond, too.
Yes.
And,
was Ward Bond an athlete also?
Oh, yes. I didn't know. Yeah, yeah, he was at SC. And then of course, I was in the picture that really made him, which was Stagecoach, which they're getting ready to remake.
You still see him quite often, Andy?
Yeah, we just finished a fishing trip together. We went down into Mexico fishing about 2 weeks ago, just before I started this trip.
How's he feeling, by the way? I know he had an operation and supposed to have been cancer.
Yeah, he had cancer, and he says there's no way. Yes, he did. Well, Jack, I think this is the first thing that the Big Duke ever run into that he couldn't. He won the war, you know. He won World War II.
And he was in all the forces, too, during the war.
That's right. And this thing, it's something. I mean, if you got a fire in the house, you can throw some water on and put it out. But this thing, I mean, it kind of whipped him, and they had him on the table for about 5 hours, and he doesn't have the strength that he did have, and he wonders why, you know. Yeah. And he went right to work, but he has whipped it, and he's in good shape, and
That's
he's a
great.
Wonderful guy. He's exactly like he.
Is he like he is on the screen?
He's a big, rough, tough guy and a lovable guy, too, with it all.
Yeah. Does he have a pretty good temper?
Yeah, I mean, it's quick. And he's one of those guys that'll turn around and bite you and then spend 3 days apologizing about it, you know?
In the hospital, of course.
Yeah.
I know, Duke. I only met him a couple of times. He's ever seen me on television a million times. He slapped me across the back, and I stayed there for 3 days on the floor.
You know, this man is amazing to me. I've met Jack and I've known him and I admire the way he works because nobody else can copy it, and they've all tried.
That's right.
But
that's
right. With this all, I have heard more wonderful things about this man
that's
and
very
the
nice
things he does, and when you talk about him, and his good things, it embarrasses him. So I think I'm enjoying embarrassing him
a little bit. That's like when he said he put 13 people through college.
Yeah.
He threw that away, but he meant it.
Well, that's not true. I'm a nice fella, and you're going to kill my image, man. I won't be able to get a job.
Yeah, you know,
I don't want to be the lovable type. There's too many around. You know.
How many years have you been married, Jack?
I've been married 20 years. 20 years, September 10th, and my wife was an acrobat. I once stole a box of rosin. She had to marry me because you couldn't find rosin in the town.
Well, you know, nobody could put up with him for 20 years if he wasn't really a pretty nice
yes.
guy.
Talk about that Wild Bill Hickok series, which is still playing around, the one you did with the guy Madison. You did that for how long?
Well, we were on that 7 years. We made 128 of them.
Then he broke the horse's back and he had to quit.
Is it tough for a heavy man to ride a horse?
Oh, no, not too heavy.
Not for a man.
No. It's, well, the horse, we used to take turns, you know. One series, I'd ride him, the next series, he'd ride me.
Well, I'm glad you said that, Andy, because we've got a horse here, and we want to see if you can still ride.
A horse, here, kid.
You and Jack, come on. Yeah,
right.
Got
a horse here?
Yeah. Jack, come here. We want to see, we want you, if you will.
That ain't a horse, that's a city.
Because Jack is a heavy man.
I'm not getting a horse, man. I got a brand new suit on.
No, come here, Jack.
First.
Now, come here. He's just going to show you how you get on a horse, well, Jack.
No, I guess I got to
see. The first.
Goodbye, Andy.
The hardest thing, the hardest thing to do is to get the foot up there, you know.
There he goes. Buck Benny rides again. Well, if he can do it, I can do it. Hello there, Fido.
Now, don't show any fear.
If this horse bites me in a rather unusual place, I'll be very upset.
You don't get bit back here, Jack. This isn't the biting end. You see where I am.
Well, I don't know. I don't know.
Jack, if you show fear,
you,
that horse will know.
The best-looking bookends I've ever seen. How do you get up on this thing here?
Well, you put first, you got to get the left foot here.
First, take your right foot, and you go to...
No, the left foot.
Don't touch me. I'm a star, sir.
Here,
I
Jack.
Hope that's water down there.
I'll tell you.
Make it get on right.
Yeah. Get up. Put the left foot in here, Jack.
I'm not riding anything out of here.
Put the left foot in the stirrup, Jack.
Put the left foot there, Jack.
Now, swing the right foot over there.
Now, the right foot. Come on here.
Yeah. Okay, go. Go there. The horse just screamed. See you later, Jack.
I had a little trouble making anything. I don't even want to walk up the stairs. That's amazing. I'm not kidding you. That's the biggest horse I've ever seen. I've never ridden a horse, you know.
Never in your life?
Really?
Not me.
Why not?
I don't know. I just never had the...
Not even as a kid? You were an athlete as a kid.
No, well, I came from a neighborhood where you used to steal cars. We never thought of horses.
You didn't steal cars, did you?
No, of course not. I went to school with a guy called Lester Gillis, who later became known as a football player, Babyface Nelson.
Did you?
He once
serious?
Stole a lagoon out of a park.
Did you go to school with Babyface Nelson?
Yeah.
What kind of a kid was he in school?
He was a nice kid. At the age of 11, he was stealing automobiles. That's no kidding. He wasn't a tough kid. I don't want to discuss my past, anyhow.
Why, Jack?
Because I don't think that I should. I don't want to live in the past, and I don't like what I'm doing.
Watch it. I almost put the wrong end in your mind.
No, this is for effect.
Oh, I see.
Boy, look at the size of that guy up there with that erector set.
We have with us today, and I know you know this kid's father very well.
Who's that?
We have Jerry Lewis, his son. With
oh,
us
yeah,
today.
This kid's very good. I tell you, for a kid that's 22, he'll be 19 again.
Here now is Gary Lewis and the Playboys.
And if I'm not first on your list,
Amazing. The kid, the strength of this kid's got to pick up that money. It's amazing.
How old are you, Gary?
19.
He's 19 and one of six. You're the eldest of six boys. Right. Is that right?
I know him since he was 1 year old.
Are you serious, Jack?
Oh, sure. Yeah. I know this family for 100 years.
What do you think about now, all of this success? Did you think you were going to be a hit when you made the first record?
No.
When you recorded Diamond Ring and you played it back, did you have any idea that this was going to happen?
No, I had no idea. I thought... I was, like, scared, you know, because I thought it was going to, you know, go. I was hoping it would go.
Did your dad help you in any way with this act?
With our act?
Yes, in picking the boys?
Uh-huh.
How come the fellows haven't got the long hair like all of the other groups, Gary?
Because our gimmick is having no gimmick.
Kid bought it. Kid bought it.
What do your parents think about the act? Let's start with your mother. What does she think?
Oh, my mom, she's great. She agreed to be our agent for 10%, and we each give her, each of the five guys, we give her 2% of our love apiece.
I see. 2% of the love.
Right.
She was quite a singer herself, you know.
I know that.
Oh, yes.
She sang with Jimmy Dorsey, didn't she, your mother? Mm-hmm. And what about your dad? What does he think about the act? Now, be honest. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. Well, he thinks what we're doing is great and that we're doing it on our own and everything like that, but rock and roll, you know...
It doesn't reach him.
I don't think he understands it.
I don't think a lot of people understand it.
I understand it.
Well, you do, Jack? Oh, what is it?
I can't stand it. That's what I mean.
But your dad has pretty good musical taste.
Yes, he has. He sings... he's still singing, you know, I Walk a Million Miles from One of Your Smiles, My Mammy, you know. That's 140 years old, by the way. Your father's a very funny man, darn it. I made a picture with his father last summer. It's called A Disorderly Orderly. I told you that before.
He saw his dad's new picture last night, didn't you?
I hear it's very
all the
funny.
Go?
Yeah.
The Family Jewels, and you were in it, weren't you?
Yes, he was.
What did you think?
Not too good.
What did you think, Gary, of what you did in the picture?
Well, I hadn't seen it, you know, any of the rushes or anything like that, so last night was the first time we saw ourselves, you know. In the picture.
And were you thrilled? All the fellas?
Yeah. Were you thrilled, Gary?
I got very excited, yes.
Did you get a funny feeling in your stomach as you're watching yourself, or what? What do you mean by that?
If you don't pay attention, I'll go away.
Never.
Okay. Okay, Jack.
Boy, you sure got a lot of nerve for a guy that can't fight, I'll tell you that.
Is it true that one of the fellas quit the group because he thought it was going to be a flop?
Right.
And have you heard from him since?
When did you rejoin him?
He came up to our house to pick up his guitar the other day, and that's it.
Speaking of guitar, I understand you've been studying guitar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Can you play?
Yes.
Well, let's find out. Yeah. We have a guitar. All right. It's all tuned up. Let's see what Gary can do. All tuned.
Should be all tuned.
Did you tune it, Chuck?
Well, what do you want me to do?
Hey, love you. Hey.
That's pretty good for a start. What's your second number?
You do folk singing, Gary?
No.
A lot of folks here. You ought to sing a few.
I tell you, boy, when a singer starts getting laughs, I better get out of town.
Okay.
Go ahead, Gary. Pick up the guitar. Show me you got a little class, strength.
What?
Well, whatever you
want. Well, play whatever you want to play, like
play a little something on there. No, seriously.
I play nothing. I mean, just chords, you know.
Well, that's all right. It's band sounds good.
Just sing a few bars and play a few chords.
That'll be very good.
Can I have a pick, please? Would you give me a pick?
He almost electrocuted himself.
All right, let me see.
Let's have, you know what I'd like for you to do, because I was talking to the fellas in the group before we went out on the air, and I found out that two of them are from Oklahoma, and another from Alabama, and another from somewhere else. Would you go out and introduce them for me and tell us where they're from? I think the people know. Let's start with Fisherman right here. Wait, I'll just fix my pants, Gary.
Okay, right here, this is John West. He plays the quarterbox. It is not really an accordion like it appears to be. It's amplified. That's John West.
Where's he from? Where's John West?
Oh, John West is from a little town 97 miles from here called Eurexville, Ohio.
Yeah. There you go.
And this is our rhythm guitarist, Dave Walker. He's from Shaker Heights. And this is our lead guitarist, Tommy Triplehorn. Where are you from? Tulsa. Tulsa. And our bass guitarist, Carl Radel, also from Tulsa.
Now, if we can get Gary Lewis of Hollywood to go back and sit at the drums, we'll hear another number. What are you going to play, Gary?
Save Your Heart For Me, our new record.
Save Your Heart For Me, Gary Lewis, from the Playboy.
Time is long ago. You'll be in my arms.
crucial days in history when Mr. McDivitt and Mr. White were in orbit with the recent Gemini shot, and the voice that we heard for those 4 days belongs to our next guest, this gentleman right here, Mr. Paul Haney. Would you welcome him, please?
Oh, welcome.
Jack Leonard and Andy Devine. Paul, what is your official title?
I'm the public affairs officer at the Manned Spacecraft Center in Houston, Texas.
What exactly does that entail? What do you do?
Oh, it takes in things like making the movies. We have a big news operation, obviously. Education, we work with a lot of schools, universities, high schools. We have a history department. And, I guess that covers it.
What is the question most often asked of you, Paul? By the average layman, I mean, not by people that you work with.
I guess it is, would have to be, why do you want to go to the moon?
Why do we want to go to the moon?
Well, I don't know. I remember one old lady in Alabama had a wonderful answer for that. She said, she wrote in and asked the question, and she said, why don't you stay home and watch television like God intended everybody to do?
Well, bless that little lady in Alabama. How about the purpose of the Gemini flight? What was the purpose of it? Are we leading up to the moon shot?
Yes, indeed. Gemini has three basic purposes, long-duration missions, extravehicular activity, and rendezvousing, mm-hmm. all of which we have to do the Apollo program.
Mr. Eisenhower called the recent Gemini flight a stunt. Do you agree with him?
I think Mr. Eisenhower can speak for himself.
You don't want to comment on that?
No, thanks.
I understand on the next shot will last 8 days now instead of the original seven that they had planned. Why eight instead of seven suddenly?
We want to get that extra time. We're going to build up to 14 days in Germany before it's all over.
When will we pass the Russians?
Hopefully on this next flight, if they don't do anything between now and then.
Are you guys really pulling for that? Do you want to get ahead of them?
Yeah, we'd like the 5 days would pass down.
We could have passed them on the last shot, couldn't we?
We really could have. We had the calories there.
How about the what he said, though, about it being a stunt? Was there much talk about that when Mr. Eisenhower said it was a stunt?
I don't recall the statement, honestly.
You don't?
I'm not trying to be defensive or evasive, but I think there was that element. But the three basic purposes that I outlined have been the goals in Gemini from the very start.
May I?
Surely, Andy.
Why would they call this a stunt when they didn't call what the Russians did a stunt?
That's a good question. Can you answer it, Paul?
Well, I think that's a pretty... It answers itself.
Yeah.
The important thing to remember is that the walk on the moon, which is going to come before the end of the decade, is nothing more than extravehicular activity. So you're going to be outside for a day or so.
Well, what was the purpose of the walk in space?
To get this first experience, mm-hmm. to get to start the old confidence build up in the equipment and the people and the procedures. Go through so many times before we try these.
You know, there was, I guess, much concern about when Mr. White was in space, about them calling him back, and he didn't come back in as soon as they intended that he would. And what was it that kept him out there longer? Did he just stay out of his own free will, or?
No, actually, he came back in about the time he should have.
It
he went out a little earlier.
I see, but it took him a little longer to get back
by
in.
By agreement, by direction.
Than they had anticipated. Is it true that they're trained well enough that they could take that whole capsule apart in the dark, put
they
it back
certainly
together?
Could, and as a fact, they did take the door apart, interestingly enough, and of course the door was one of the
they had big trouble
items,
getting it closed, didn't they?
They had to go to the secondary mode of closing it, and it paid off very well.
If something happens on the blast-off, on the takeoff, who makes the decision whether or not to eject?
The command pilot has to, well, either pilot can do it, but the primary responsibility is on the command pilot. He's got something called a chicken switch.
millions of dollars for a chicken switch.
What would that cost the taxpayers if something did go wrong, let's say on the most recent shot, the two-man shot, and they would have ejected? What would that have cost?
I think the total price tag hung on one of those booster rocket, all the people around the world, everything about $35 million.
Wow. You can buy a new car with that.
Not in Texas.
No, that's right. I like that line. The guy says, how come he didn't come back soon enough when he walked out there in space? He didn't like the plumbing.
Well, Paul, what is the film that you brought? What are we going
to
see?
This is just a quickie treatment on the flight, if you'd like to see.
Yes, we'd like very much to see
it. Walk, and there's Ed going outside now.
That's funny.
And he's got his little maneuvering gun. He's going to make a left turn now and wait for the light to change.
Uh-huh. Does the glove come out on this thing and fly around, too, with him, 17,000 miles an hour?
No, let's watch. The thing you see swaying in the breeze there is the bag that in which the umbilical was stored earlier, prior to the EVA. You know, it's interesting. I was out in the carrier right after the flight. And the second night, we were alongside the Florida coast and in range of a Jacksonville television station when they showed these pictures for the first time. And I was sitting with Ed, and it was really something to see. He lifted off right out of the chair, watching it again for the first time.
Fantastic.
Well, what is he
there
talking
the glove
about
right
now?
Right there. Yeah,
that's
glove.
The glove.
Mm-hmm.
He used to play with the Mets.
Waving.
What was he saying, Paul, do you recall at this point?
Well, I remember he started off talking about the California coast, that he could see that, and then you recall the discussion over Houston where he could see the Galveston Bay.
Mm-hmm. How far from Earth at this point? A hundred and some odd miles?
It was 120, 125 miles.
And how far did he get from the capsule at this point?
24 feet is the maximum distance.
Mm-hmm.
He actually said he came back and did a little dance. He walked up the spacecraft and walked all around it, walked behind it, looked at the thrusters.
And, he must have a very good sense of humor.
He got a tremendous sense of balance, too.
Yeah, I would say.
I'm glad.
What was his reaction to this film when he saw the film?
Well, he just, elation, I guess, is the only word I can think of. Mm-hmm. I remember he just lifted right out of his chair when the door opened and he went out. And,
at this point, how fast is the craft moving?
5 miles a second.
That's approximately 17,000 and some odd miles per hour?
Yeah, just a little under 18,000.
A little under 18,000 miles per hour. And you have no feeling of movement at all up there. Is that
right? Has to give him the cross-country walking record. He walked across the United States in 12 minutes.
You got to get a job at a New Haven Railroad. That's wonderful. I thought they were color. They were fantastic.
Paul, why didn't both astronauts walk in space? Why just one?
Well, we wanted to have good control on the spacecraft.
There was some problem controlling the spacecraft when he was walking in space, wasn't there?
We wanted good stability to see how well he could maneuver, you see, because later on we figure the people have to go out and work on other items, other spacecraft, perhaps go up and repair one.
Mm-hmm. You know, yesterday I heard them say that they're going to publish a whole new list of new young men who have been chosen as future astronauts. How much actual training, and how do they decide on whether a man is capable of that sort of thing? How long does it take to make that decision?
This group will be our scientific astronauts, where for the first time we've not gone out for pilot experience, we've gone out for the heavy science backgrounds.
Mm-hmm. So the man has to not only have the capable brain power, but he has to be a good physical specimen, doesn't he?
Indeed they do, and they work awfully hard at it. They've got a gym.
How hard do they work? How hard did McDivitt and White work before the
shot? White is a tremendous athlete anyway. He was an Olympic runner at West Point.
Yes, I know that.
The 400-meter hurdles, which I think is about the toughest race in track.
Mm-hmm.
And Ed can still run a quarter mile in 52 seconds, which a lot of collegians would aspire
fast.
That's very good.
How about the future, the next step in the program? What will that be?
Longer missions, and of course, by the end of the year, we want to actually do this rendezvous maneuver for the first time. That is, go up and meet another independently launched bird.
Spacecraft or another?
We hope to do that before Christmas.
Is that what you use the word, the bird? Is that what you call them, birds?
The birds, the boosters. Birds.
Yeah. That's wonderful.
Now, in the next shot that will be coming up, the eight-day thing, will a man take a walk in space at that time, too?
It's a little open-ended right now. We really don't have any demand or requirement to put it in the space agency parlance. But it's the equipment's there, and the man, Pete Conrad, has been trained. He can do it.
Paul, I want to thank you so much. I'm happy that you had to come home and visit your family so that you could be with us. Thank you. We'll be right back. Paul, young lady has a pretty interesting success story to tell. Now, we're going to talk to her completely about it. Maybe you read a recent article in the National Magazine about this lovely young lady. She has sold an awful lot of recordings, and I'm sure all of you young people know about her. And if you have a radio, you must know Miss Leslie Gore. Welcome her.
Hey,
sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows. Everything that's wonderful is what I feel when we're together. Brighter than a lucky penny. When you're near, the rain goes, disappears, dear, and I feel so fine just to know that you are mine. My life is sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows. That's how this refrain goes, so come on, join in. Everybody's sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows. Everything that's wonderful is sure to come your way when you're in love to stay. Sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows. Everything that's wonderful is what I feel when we're together. Brighter than a lucky penny. When you're near, the rain just disappears, dear, and I feel so fine just to know that you are mine. My life is sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows. That's how this refrain goes, so come on, join in. Everybody's sunshine, lollipops, and wonderful is sure to come your way. Cause you're in love, and love is here to stay.
We'll be right back.
Is this a recent recording of yours?
No, I recorded it on my first album.
Why did you choose a song that had been around a couple of times?
Because my first album was I'll Cry If I Want To, which
you had to have a lot of cry songs in there.
Right, so we did this next song I'm going to do for you.
Leslie Gore singing Cry Me a River.
Thank you.
Leslie Gore.
You're so young.
Would you mind giving me your mother's phone number?
How are you?
How about your mother's phone number?
Right
here. Right. Sit right there, dear. You sing awfully good. I'll tell you about you. You know, I'm not kidding. You got nice style.
Thank you.
Oh, how old are you, Leslie?
I'm 19.
Gee, you're getting old.
Are you a student?
Everybody's 19. Everybody's 19. She's character parts.
I'm a student at Sarah Lawrence College, yes.
Oh, that's a fine school.
I just completed my...
You in Worth Hall?
Pardon me?
Are you in Worth Hall?
Worth Hall. Is that at Sarah Lawrence?
I thought it was.
Maybe you're thinking of St.
Louis. No, that's in Pittsburgh. It's a mining camp you're talking about.
What is your major at school?
I'm majoring in literature.
What are you going to do? You're going to be a teacher?
Maybe I'll be a teacher.
Gee, that'd be very good. Cry me a river and you say, how about Shakespeare? That'd be very good.
Well, the way your career is going, you might not have to turn to teaching.
Well, I thought I'd like to study literature and possibly train for becoming a teacher.
That's nice.
If I wanted something to fall back on.
Do you think you'd like to be a teacher?
No.
Well, there's nothing I can say. I just wondering why.
I like the field that I'm studying now, and if I wanted to teach, I would like to be able to. Not so much because I'm so crazy about the field. I much prefer to stay in the music business.
You like this? How long have you been singing, actually?
2 years.
And you sing around the parties around New Jersey, no swamps and all that place around it?
We take off our shoes and walk in the swamps.
No kidding. And what do you get? They used to sing Chloe all through there years ago.
Is this true what I read in this Life magazine article that you get an allowance of $30 a week?
Well, this was when I was up at school and I had to pay my own telephone bill. Now that I'm home and for the summer, it's been cut down because my father takes care of the phone bill now.
Very nice. But the $30 a week.
$30 a week you spend on phone calls, huh?
Well, no, not quite that much. There's food, you know, snacks in there, and there's cleaning and laundry and books out of that.
Your father, what business is your father?
He's president of Peter Pan Swimwear.
Is he really?
Really?
Gee, I got to talk to him. I need a new bikini.
There's one little...
I'm sure you could arrange something.
There's one little quote I want to ask Leslie about. She says, even if it all ended tomorrow, I'd still have lots to tell my grandchildren. What would you tell your grandchildren about what you've done?
I'd tell them all about how I recorded It's My Party, and before I knew it, everybody was playing it on the radio or something. I couldn't quite figure that out. I can't still figure out how the radio works, you know? You turn it on in the car, and a voice comes out.
You can't figure that out?
No, I can't figure out how that
works.
That's
new. That's no kidding.
TV's even more complicated.
Why don't you ask them at Sarah Lawrence? They'll explain it to you.
And then I would tell them about all the different places I've been, places I've traveled.
Where have you been since you became a star?
We've traveled most all over the United States.
I think the astronaut's back in.
Thank you, Jack. You travel all over
the United States.
Have you been to Europe yet? Have you?
Have you worked in Europe?
Yes.
No kidding. Where did you go, man? You don't mind me taking over, do you, Mike?
Oh, go right ahead, Jack.
Where'd you work in Europe, dear?
Well, I worked, let me see. I went to Germany and recorded in German. I recorded in Italian. I went to France and cut in French over there.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Been to some very interesting places, and of course, I've met many very interesting people.
Have you fallen in love yet in the different parts of the world?
No.
How about a guy in Jersey? You come from New Jersey. There must be somebody there you like.
Well, there are some very nice people in New Jersey.
That's very nice of you to say that. I know they're all be choked up about that when they hear about that.
We have some of the finest people in New
Jersey. Who do you talk to on the phone? You make a lot of phone calls.
Well, I call...
Your family's very close.
I call home a lot is what I do. That's why.
I think that's very nice of you to do that. I can't get over that.
Who do you talk to when you call home?
Well, I have my brother at home. My parents live at home there.
And your parents live at home? I think that's wonderful of them to do it.
They've been there for a while now.
How old's your brother, Leslie? How old's your brother?
He's 14.
And you're 19. What do teenagers talk about?
What do they talk about? Are you kidding?
No, I want to know. What do teenagers talk about?
Teenagers, what do they talk about? Well, they're concerned with their school right now. They're concerned with who's going to be on television next week. They're concerned with who's coming into the Paramount Theater so that they can run down there and see the next show.
Yeah, that's a lot of stuff.
We've got plenty of things to talk about.
Isn't that wonderful? It's really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Are you and your brother very close?
Very close, yes.
How about dating? Is that a big problem with you being in the room
so much? No, this chick. Look how pretty she is. Are you kidding?
Well, she's gone so
problem.
Much.
$30 a week for spending for just phone calls? She must be calling Asia.
How about the dating problem and getting to know a boy when you travel so much?
Maybe it's a little bit more difficult. Well, I don't usually travel during the year, not while I'm at school. I travel during the summer. I travel on my vacation. Because really, if you... I can't even take off weekends too many times at school because... You got to start working for the next week.
That's true. With your career going as well as it is now going, Do you think you would ever quit school and just pursue a career?
No, I don't think
You're
so.
You're going to finish.
I'm going to finish.
Well, because she gets a big chunk of dough if she graduates, you see. I was talking to her mother the other day.
Did you meet my mother?
Oh, she's a beautiful looking lady. Is your father very strong?
Yes, he's quite strong.
I like the lie that your mother told me. She goes to Sarah Lawrence. She says, I think you ought to go to Sarah Lee and learn how to cook.
I'd like to hear Leslie Gore sing again, wouldn't you?
I certainly. I've been going.
Microphone, please. Miss Leslie Gore. Stretch? What happened? Oh, they can't get the band to work. Somebody unplugged the band. I'll tell you what's happening. Now, this is the background, the actual background of a recording that Ms. Gore has made, and she sings live here with the background. So you're going to hear Ms. Leslie Gore singing a great song by Anthony Newley. Am I right?
That's right.
What Kind of Fool Am I?
What Kind of Fool Am I? What kind of fool am I? Never fell in love. It seems that I'm the only one that I have been thinking of. What kind of life is this? An empty shell, a lonely cell in which an empty heart must dwell. What kind of lips are these that lied with every kiss, that whispered empty words of love, that left me alone like this? Why can't I fall in love like other people can? And maybe then I'll know what kind of fool I am. What kind of fool am I, who never fell in love? Why can't I fall in love like other people can? And maybe then I'll know what kind of fool I am.
Where are you going to be so the people can be looking for you?
Well, I open the 6th of July in Barnesville, Pennsylvania, with a show called Never Too Late.
Oh, that's a great play. Yeah. Oh, that's a great play.
And then I go from there into Detroit and up to Houghton Lake, Michigan. And then I'm going to do another wonderful old show on borrowed time in Indianapolis, Indiana. And then I go to Louisville, Kentucky.
Oh, you folks in all of those cities be looking for Andy Devine.
Yeah.
Andy did Captain Andy, you know, and...
The showboat.
Yes, I know. Gee, you make a great captain. I'm not kidding you.
Thank you.
Oh, you know, that's all right.
I don't know how many of you. Do you know Ken Venturi, the U.S. Open champ?
Why, of course. Everybody knows. You mean the guy? Oh, the fellow with the bat. Oh, that's a tough break.
I want to tell you something. Ken is a very dear friend of mine, a dear personal friend of mine. And he won the U.S. Open in last year, 1964. And it was one of the most dramatic comebacks in the sports field for many years. And he started having problems with his right hand, the blood circulation.
Yes.
And he tried everything. He'd been to Mayo Brothers, and they were able to name the disease, but they said we don't have any known cure for it at the moment. And I want you to know that they performed an operation on Ken yesterday, and it was medically successful, and I couldn't be more pleased.
Oh, that's wonderful. Oh, that's great.
This is so good.
The reason I brought this up is that before the Cleveland Open, I went out to Highland Park and taped some shots with Arnold Palmer and Tony Lima and Kenny Venturi and Sammy Snead and all of them. And you're going to be seeing them from time to time on the show. But right now, I want to show you a tape that I made with Ken Venturi before the Cleveland Open and before the operation. Would you roll it, Rods, please?
Ladies and gentlemen, you're eavesdropping on the 1964 U.S. Open champ, man that made the comeback of the year and won every conceivable award, Mr. Ken Venturi. I'd like to hit him on like that, Ken. How are you?
Hey, Mike. How are you?
Good today?
Oh, good.
Very good.
Ken, I want to talk a little bit about your dramatic finish in the Open and the fact that many people didn't think you would make it at all. What drives a guy to pull one out like that? I mean, you had been in a slump. Everyone had been reading about it, and suddenly you played magnificent golf and were plagued by the heat and still came through and won it. What did it for you?
I think it was just 3 years of just being tired and of trying and just figured that that was the last shot I had.
I understand that you've just written a book about the life of Ken Venturi. What's it called?
I just finished the book. It'll be out on 1st November. It's called The Ken Venturi Story. It's called Where Do I Go From Here?
What does that mean, Ken? You wonder where you can go from
here? Well, I guess the whole book has the theme of that title because when I started, I had great success, and so where could I go? And from there, you know, and then when I went down, I didn't think I could go much lower, so then again is where could I go from there? And then so then after winning the Open and then having a little bit of trouble that I've had and my hands and things, it's still another question of where do I go from here.
How about the trouble with your hands? I've been how do they feel today?
Well, they're good if it's warm, but you can see them, see what happens to them. They just blanch a little bit, so and then finning gets a little difficult, but I think if I had to do all over again, I wouldn't change for 64. I'd even keep them with those.
Yeah, that's great. Now, tell us about the priest that you met who helped you with your thinking and made you helped you think positively and go on to make the comeback of the year and win the U.S. Open. What is his name? Is he still with you?
Yeah, Father Frank Murray is a good friend of mine. In fact, we've been friends for some time, not too long, but I'd say he's probably as close as anyone could get. And he wrote me a letter the day before the Open when he was on retreat. And it was a classical letter. In fact, I have it printed in the book. It's in the book. And
I don't want you to try to remember.
He gave me the inspiration of the whole thing. I mean, he gave me a mood to set, and how it was done, Mike, was unbelievable, because to read it now, you'd think that the letter was written after I had won, because the way he calls how hot it will be, and he calls it that I'll be behind maybe on the last days, and then I'll have to get going, and that to make my birdies early on Saturday, which I went out in 30. So he just laid the plan, and it just fell right into play. Well, it's unbelievable what he wrote it.
It really and truly is a great comeback, and we hope that your day today is a good one, Ken. And you are so great with long irons. And this is a shot that many people don't quite understand. I know that the pros advocate hitting down through the ball a great deal, but a lot of people are mixed up on the long irons as opposed to the short irons. They think that you should take the divot as you do with the shorter irons, and this is not true.
No, it's almost picking the ball. It's not
sweeping it clean.
Well, you take a little divot to hit it on a downward swing, but I think the biggest factor in long irons is that not trying to hit them hard. I think you should swing as easy at a 2 or 3 as you do a 5 or 6 or maybe an 8 iron, because the idea first people think of trying to get the ball in the air, but you should let your swing get it in the air.
All right. Would you show us? Now, what iron is that?
2.
A 2 iron?
Yeah.
Could you show us how to hit a long iron, Ken?
Is that the way you showed me?
Okay. The way I showed you, sure. Yeah, I don't understand how you get that much loft. That's a 2 iron. Now, what is the maximum distance for a 2 iron, approximately?
Oh, it depends who you are. Me, it's about 200 yards. You take some up and down the line there, it's about 230.
Is that right?
But I think the irons, because you have a lot of irons, it's what the iron you can get, take the best swing, because if you don't have enough with a 3, then a hit a 2, and then go back to a wood if you have to, but it's not trying to press it.
Well, actually, for an amateur, long irons are the most difficult. Would you hit another one so we can get an idea of what that looks
like?
Mike. Oh, you really hit that one.
Better remember that swing.
Yeah, can you hit another one, Kenny? And I want you to, you were saying some of the fellas hit them maybe 230 yards. I want you to really smoke this one. Yes, please.
Oh,
he took me at my word, didn't he? Ken Venturi, thank you, Kenny, so much.
Thanks, Mike.
Be right back following these messages. Right back.
Yes, that's
everybody
very
does an number. Even Andy's going to sing for us today. Huh? Get us started.
I'm going to put a pile of gravel in my mouth.
You like that tempo, Jack?
I always like that.
It's a great dancing tempo. You want to dance?
You got to give a little.
A little choral work here.
Oh, I can't.
Take a little. And let your poor heart break a little. That's the story of.
You your mother's phone number?
That's the glory of love.
Go, baby!
You've got to win a little.
I want
to
say.
Lose a little. And always have the blues.
Oh, shut up.
Lose a little.
Come here.
That's the story. You lip sync for me. That's the glory of love.
As long as there's the two.
I know.
As long as there's the two of us, we got the world and all of its charms.
Go, Jack, now.
And when the world is through with us, we've got each other's arms. You got to laugh a little, cry a little, and let the clouds roll by a little. That is the story of. That's the glory of love. It is the story and the glory of love. Yeah.
Thank you. I think the choreography on that number was superb. Don't you like Mr. Jackie Leonard's dancing? And now, Andy Devine.
That's just ought to be very good.
Andy?
I ain't gonna hear a highway sing.
You never learned it. You can't even ride a horse. For it's blood on the saddle, blood all around, and a great big puddle of blood all around.
I think it's gonna happen again.
Petey the cowboy, he'll ride no more.
Oh, God.
There is his saddle,
Johnny,
all covered with gore. Poor little Petey, there he lies dead, cause his bronchus stopped and rolled on his head. For his blood on his saddle, blood all around,
oh,
and a great big puddle of blood all around.
And now, Jack,
that's a great song for the mafia, there's blood on the saddle.
It's time for you to follow. Well,
I want the full band. I want the organ
band
to lay back, and I want the French horns to keep quiet while I'm working.
Jackie Leonard, it all depends on you, Jack.
Well, you hear this. This will stone you. What are you playing?
She's playing Dinah. What are you singing?
I can be happy. I can be sad. I can be good. So bad, it all depends on you. I can be lonely out in a crowd. I can be humble, humble, so proud. I know the words, sir. It all depends on you. Just wait a minute. I can make money. I can be almost anything at all. Marsh.
Leslie, you said a moment ago that you like to talk on the phone, and there's a teenager calling who wants, she's a fan of yours, and wants to talk to you. So just a moment, I'll get the phone.
Thank you.
Don't you think I'm a hump sitting here to kill the time?
This is for you, Leslie Gore.
Leslie Gore.
Hello.
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 Hiya, this is Mike.
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 How are you?
That's our brother. See, we fooled her.
Where are you?
See, she calls all the time.
Where are you, honey?
I'm at home.
Did you finish school?
Yes, I finished school.
How'd it go?
Great. I came out with all A's and B pluses.
Hey, I'll see you later on today.
Yes.
I'll be home tonight.
No, you won't.
No, I won't.
Hey, Mike, what's your mother's phone number?
There's a gentleman here who's very fond of Mother.
Really?
Yes.
What's his name?
Jackie Leonard.
Okay,
Mike.
This song is a request.
Yes.
I will.
Okay, dear.
By the way, Mike, I have
yes.
a favor.
You have a favor?
Yes, I do.
What?
Do you think, for me, you can sing It's My Party?
It's my what?
It's my party.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Do you think, for me, you can sing It's My Party?
Okay, dear. I'll see you later.
Jackie Leonard for being my co-star. Mr. Andy Devine, everybody.